So hello everyone, welcome to the Moodle Academy webinar on active flipped learning. I'm here with Matt Smith today from University College London, and I had the pleasure of working with Matt when I myself worked at UCL a few years ago, and I'm excited that we have the opportunity to hear from him about his work on active flipped learning. So without further ado, here's Matt to tell us all about it. Over to you, Matt.
Thanks, Jess. So as Jess says, I work at University College London, or UCL, as I'm sure you're familiar with. And I've worked there in various learning technology and instructional design roles from 2014. I started working in the School of Management, and then after a couple of years, I moved to the Faculty of Engineering Sciences. And the presentation I'm going to give today brings together a lot of work I've done in that time, both with colleagues in the School of Management and within the engineering faculty. So as you can see from this title slide, Dr. Sarah Warnes and Mateus de Andrade, I've worked with on this method over many years, and we're going to be showing some of their work as part of the presentation. Sarah Warnes in particular, we worked for 5 years together, introducing new kind of pedagogies and things to her modules. So it was certainly a team effort between the two of us to gain the insights that I'm going to share with you today. So really, today is going to be around what we believe makes for effective flipped learning. So it's a term that's been around for many years. I'm sure you're already familiar with it and have a lot of knowledge about it. But what we've found is through kind of implementing that model, using Moodle quiz, we've actually been able to achieve really high pre-class completion rates, and created a model that we think kind of goes towards what we would kind of see as a paradigm for flipped learning. So there's a Q&A session towards the end. And if there's questions that come up, as you say, Jess, I'm happy to take some as we go. But I think it's probably best to say most until the end, because they'll probably be answered as I get through the presentation. So we're just going to start off with a quick activity. So I'd like you to just get a pen and paper or a notes app or something like that. So just give you a minute to do that. Okay, so this was a lecture from when I first started working with Sarah, and this is the approach common when you're starting to move to flipped learning. This is the kind of thing that you would do. But what I'd like is for yourselves to do this. So if you could take a piece of paper, number 1 to 8, and for each of these activities, just put an X as to whether this is an activity that would be most effectively delivered during the face-to-face time, so when the lecturer is there with the students, or out of class in the student's own kind of independent study time. You don't necessarily need to know exactly what all of these different things are, like the Ansoff matrix. So if you could just come up with a general kind of first go at what you might include in class and what you might include out of class. So I'll just give you a couple of minutes to do that. Okay, for anyone that's joined while we were in the middle of that, we're just starting with an activity here. We have a lecture and the learning activities that were part of the lecture on a understanding management undergraduate module. And this is the first stage when we started working on Sarah Warnes' module to start flipping activities. So I'd just like to open it to the floor and ask some people to share if they're comfortable, what they would decide based on this. Which activities would you put in class, which would you put out of class? Would anyone like to have a go?
We've got a few coming through on the chat. So Juan Carlos has said 1 and 2 in, and 4 and 5, 3, 6 okay, and 7 out, and 8 is both.
Great stuff. Can we hear from you, Juan Carlos, or are you not in a position to be able to unmute?
If anyone else wants to speak as well, they can raise their hand.
Okay, I think we'll move on then, because I don't think people necessarily are in a position to kind of unmute and share the discussions. But we'll have a look in the chat and the ones that people have put. So, when Carlos, you were saying 1 and 2 in class, 3 out of class, 4 and 5 in class, 6 and 7 out, and 8 in or out. So I think that was a you were kind of hedging your bets with that last one. So Justina, 1, 2, 4, 5, 6, and 8 in class. Christine has been a bit more kind of adventurous here and suggesting only 5, 6, and 8 would be in the classroom. So that's a discussion of the answer of the identify target markets and then a discussion of marketing. And the set, something similar with via, say, 3 activities, 2, 5, and 8. It's a presentation of the textbook example, the discussion, and then the discussion again. Okay, great stuff. So I'll show you where we actually kind of got to when we were doing this.
Manfred also was saying that anything with text-orientated items can be done at home and discussions in class.
Yeah, exactly. So where we actually got to all those years ago now, when we first started doing this in 2015, was we decided that 2 of them would remain during the in-class face-to-face time, but the rest of it would go out of class. And of course, you know, you don't have the context. It might be that some of these are, you know, just reinforcing knowledge, and they could take place in the class. But in this particular instance, we decided the 2 discussion activities would remain in class, but the rest could be taught pre-class. So when we first did this, Sarah was quite uneasy, as you can imagine, because she'd been lecturing like this for a number of years. And she, you know, immediately thought, well, what am I going to do in my lecture, because you're basically taking 80% of it and moving it as pre-class activities. So there was a little bit of trepidation, but she really wanted to innovate. And as we kind of started working together, she saw the value of moving to this kind of model. So the reason that we kind of decided to approach the activities in this way is we based it on Bloom's taxonomy, which I'm sure you're all very familiar with. And I'll share a slide next, but in effect, the higher level learning activities, so any activity that went above the remember and understand level on the cognitive domain, we decided we can deliver that pre-class, and anything that went above from apply, analyze, evaluate, create, we decided that's best delivered in the presence of the subject specialist. So as I say, I'm sure, you know, most of you, if not all of you, are very familiar with Bloom's taxonomy. But when it comes to categorizing learning activities, you know, it's still something I use on a very regular basis, designing online courses and constantly mapping against these and working out the kind of the flow of the learning. So as I say, those bottom two, understand and remember, anything that hit those, we decided we could do out of class. And a little bit of application as well. So the first time they apply things, they could have a go before class. But then when they're kind of applying in anger, then in the presence of the subject specialist, we find to be more effective. It looks like there's a hand raised.
So Vaya in the chat was just saying it depends on whether out of class also means asynchronously. It could be a discussion via Zoom or Teams. And especially, I suppose, since COVID, that's a good point. Does in class mean also online?
So in class means any time in the presence of the teacher. So if the teacher's not there, then from what I'm referring to today, that is out of class. So, yeah, they could do discussions with their peers and things like that. But this is face-to-face contact time with a teacher. That's what we're talking about when we're saying in class. Okay. So again, I'm sure you're really familiar with this. I'm going to kind of zip through it quite quickly. But the first thing to kind of mention is, despite how familiar you may be, again, I'm sure you're aware there's lots of different activity that takes place under the banner of flipped learning. And it's been a buzzword for, you know, over a decade, maybe coming up to 2 decades now. But actually, there's not much commonality if you look at the literature between some people that say they're doing flipped learning in one place and then in another place. So the kind of common aspects of flipped learning are these, really. And basically, that's all that we could say would be kind of common to most of the models. So the information transmission is moved out of class into that non-contact time, and then the class time is freed up for collaborative and active learning. The students are required to complete those out of class activities before the class, and it's facilitated by web technologies. So the kind of implication that, you know, obviously in order to be able to effectively take part in the collaborative and active learning, that you've done the pre-class activities. So, you know, often it's the case, and this is since COVID as well, there are people that I speak to that say, yeah, I you know, have a flipped classroom model, and I have my lectures from last year, which are an hour long that I recorded, and the students watch that hour's recording, and then they come to class, and then, you know, we kind of do collaborative, you know, activities. But as you'll see as we go on, we've not found that to be effective. And from our point of view, really, I'd say it goes against the original spirit of the flipped classroom from back in 2000, as I'll get on to. And there's many models where people are, yeah, just saying, you know, here's a 1 hour video to watch, or here's just some videos and maybe the odd multiple choice quiz. From our point of view, what we've found is that's not really effective as a model. And I think that's why so often people say it doesn't work, because they try and do that, and then they see that a lot of the students aren't engaging, or that they come to the class without the prerequisite knowledge required to take part in the collaborative activities. And then they just see it as a kind of a failed approach to teaching. So what we're going to do is just talk through a little bit, like I say, of the origins. So this is the earliest reference in the literature to flipped classrooms. So this was Baker in 2000. And well, for Baker, the flipped classroom didn't constitute purely passive pre-class activity. So it wasn't just watch this video, read this article, and then now we'll do all of the active learning in class. So there was some passive content where the students were kind of absorbing information, but they would also be required to take part in discussions, quiz questions, and more kind of application-based activities before they came to class. It was after this point that it started to move for many people to just becoming, do this pre-reading, watch these pre-class videos. So what we've done is taken that core from Baker's original work, and then we've added many other types of activities and question types from kind of self-reflective questions to actual submissions. And what we've found is having the active elements as part of the pre-class activities is what's key to making the whole thing work. So that's why we've been using this phrase, because it attempts to underline the importance of the active learning activities right through both parts, both the pre-class and the in-class. And as I say, we've found that Moodle Quiz Tool is super effective for doing this. And we're now going to kind of move on and look at a case study, which was Sarah's module, and I'll show you how it kind of works in practice. So understanding management is an undergraduate elective module at UCL. So it's elective, meaning that students from a number of different subjects can take it. It's not just students in the School of Management. She has roughly 120 students per cohort, and it's assessed via a coursework and a presentation. So we thought this was actually a really good module to first test the approach on, because you have students from lots of different disciplines, from, you know, engineering disciplines, also from humanities, and also different levels. So we'd have year one students and year three students all taking part in this elective module. And what we were trying to kind of move to was having a scenario where there, you know, we achieved this blend. And, you know, that's worth pointing out that flipped learning is a vehicle for effective blended learning. Sometimes people, you know, don't kind of view it as blended learning, but blended learning is an umbrella which flipped learning sits within. It's a flavor of blended learning. So we really wanted to move to a model of blended learning where the online work that they were taking, you know, in that non-contact time, which, you know, as it's labeled here, out of class, but in that non-contact time, that asynchronous online learning we wanted to that to be as much a part of the module in the minds of the students as the seminars that they have and the lectures they have. Because so often, up until this point at least, it was always seen as an afterthought. And since COVID, it is still on many modules. It's just an afterthought. It's not integral to the actual pedagogy for the module. So this is how we originally kind of flagged them. And like I say, this work goes back to 2015. So this is an old looking version of Moodle, as I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with. This was like, 3.1 or something like that. And this is how we flagged them up to students. We called them flips because we thought it was a kind of a good way to brand it in the mind of the students. And it was something that Sarah referred to a lot in the face-to-face time. Yeah, sorry, there's a hand raised.
Yeah, there's a question from Vaya. What is the difference between a lecture and a seminar?
Okay, sure. Yeah. So I don't know if this is the case around the world, but in the UK, a lecture is generally a very large class. So, on Sarah's module, her lectures would be 120 students, but the seminars would maybe be 15 students, and they would run multiple seminars. So that's kind of small group teaching, whereas the lectures when everyone's there in a room together. And yeah, there's some modules actually at UCL where we have 1,000 students, so they might get split up into then two lectures of 500 each. But generally speaking, yeah, in a lecture theatre, the academics at the front, often on a stage, and there's, all the students there, or a large number of them. And then in a seminar, it will usually be in a smaller room, sitting around a table, and students will be working in a small group. So in terms of how we then kind of created these activities, we tried to make sure that things weren't passive. So that's what this illustration kind of shows. This is a French illustration when they were looking at what will the world be like in the year 2000. But this kind of highlights the idea that, students are passively just absorbing information. So we've got this kind of French teacher loading books into a hopper, and it's going straight into the students. And that's, for me, what represents a lot of what people do when they say it's flipping. They say, as I say, watch this video, read this article. The idea is the students just absorb this. What we're saying is they need to do active tasks as part of those pre-class activities. So as well as watching a video or doing a reading or listening to a podcast, we need them to do activities embedded around those where they actually start to use some of the knowledge they're learning or we're testing it. So moving on, I can show you some examples of that. So the first one here, this is just a short form question, and we've given the students some stimulus material. So this relates directly to that table I showed you at the beginning where we had the different activities. And this was the activity, I think it was possibly the third one down, about identifying target markets. So this is something Sarah used to do in the lecture, and she'd be up front talking through this. This then took place before class. And as you can see, it's not just an answer where they give us, it's not they give a simple answer here. They're going to have to think about this. We're saying, here's a range of Heinz beans. Who do you think that this new range of beans is marketed at? So the students need to think about, what's the packaging look like, and who might be, interested in this product. And then they came up with their three target markets that they felt Heinz were targeting with the new product range. So that's a kind of a short form question. And again, this is all using the quiz. Like I say, the screenshots are now from a previous version of Moodle, but it's all still possible within quiz. The next one we have here relates to the Ansoff matrix activity you saw, where Sarah here is giving a presentation of the Ansoff matrix. So again, she used to stand at the front and give this presentation for 10 minutes in the lecture. Here she's doing it in a short video. And then we're asking the students to actually create their own Ansoff matrix and submit it to the submission inbox link that we've included there. So again, in this case, it's not merely watch the video and move on. It's watch the video, now go away for half an hour with a pen and paper and create your own Ansoff matrix for Heinz or Kraft, which are the two companies that were being studied as part of the module. And in terms of Ansoff matrix, it's just a kind of, as it says here, strategic planning tool to see where products are in their life cycle. So it's a way to kind of analyze a product portfolio. So the students did that, and then they submitted them to this inbox as part of the pre-class activities. And then here's an example of more a kind of treasure hunt style activity where we got students to take photographs of spaces that they find inspiring. So the idea was they were looking at how innovative organizations often have innovative spaces as part of their offices, and thinking about how space can influence productivity and things like that. So the idea was, yeah, they took photos of spaces that they find inspiring to work in and those they find uninspiring to work in. So before every before every lecture, that face-to-face time, using the quiz, Sarah was able to very quickly download all of these responses. And this is the bits that are key to making the flip model effective. So she was able to analyze these and she was able to see where are the gaps in knowledge. So because she could see what the students thought about, for example, you know, the target markets for the Heinz, so that's response 7 there, or response 2 is you know, was about giving a definition of marketing. If she saw in this column here, labeled response 2, that none of the students understood what marketing was when asked to give a definition, she knows then in her lecture, actually, she needs to give a short recap about what is marketing because, you know, from the material she's provided, the students still haven't got it. Or equally for the kind of Heinz quiz question there, if the target markets there coming up with a completely off the mark, again, she'd be able to kind of judge that the students haven't fully grasped how organizations go around targeting different markets. So the point of this allows her to then target her face-to-face time to actually the needs of the students and the gaps in knowledge. If there's things here that they understand really well, there's no reason for Sarah to be covering them again. So the next thing she did was use the in-class responses. And this is the thing that we've found key to all of it, really. And if, you know, if you can take one thing away from this presentation, it would be this. To show that the students are completing these activities for something that's important, it's vital that you link the pre-class activities to the face-to-face time. So if students are working through all of these pre-class activities, they arrive at the face-to-face time, be it a lecture or a seminar, and nothing that they've done before class is referenced or used, they won't see any value in completing those activities. And you'll see the kind of engagement rates in completion just drop off as the module progresses. So we kind of didn't know this when we started, but as we went through this work, we realized actually this is the most effective way to build that link between the pre-class non-contact time and then that contact time with the teacher. So, and it's really simple to do, and this is where we found Moodle quiz to be amazing, because we can really quickly download all those responses. Sarah could take them and she could then turn them into something like a word cloud. So when the students are sitting in that lecture, Sarah would put up a slide and say, remember that activity you did about identifying the target markets for Heinz beans? This is what you thought. These are the markets that you thought they were targeting. And then this acts as a really good springboard for discussion, because she can say, look, you know, the most popular response is young people. And who put young people? Why did you put young people? And then they can start that discussion. You know, who put teenagers? Why did you put teenagers? Or vegetarians? Or, you know, food lovers or whatever it is. So like I say, if you can remember anything, it's this, that if you can take the student responses and visualize them in some way that you can then use in the face-to-face time, that will do wonders for the completion rates for the pre-class activities. To give you a few other examples, here's the Ansoff matrix. And this is a student-submitted one. So from that example I showed you, this is one that a student in her class submitted. And as you can see, it's pretty sophisticated. And, you know, this isn't something that they needed to do in class. The student was able to watch the video. They were able to understand what was going on and then create their own Ansoff matrix, which when Sarah looked at it, was as good as, you know, she would have seen in previous years, having done it all in the class time. And she would take that as well, and she would then use that in her lecture too. So this is a slide from her lecture where she took that Ansoff matrix. And again, she said, you know, this is a real Ansoff matrix that, you know, one of the students in the class has created. She wouldn't, you know, name their names because she didn't necessarily want to kind of draw attention to the student. But it was really nice because when we got the feedback, the students could see when it was their work that she was showing. So although she didn't put their names on it in the class, they would say, oh, you know, thanks so much for choosing my one to use in the lecture and things like that. So we got really positive feedback about that. And what she then did was she flew in some other answers from other students. And again, she was able to, you know, use this as a springboard for discussing the Ansoff matrix and, you know, what bits, you know, maybe they hadn't thought about as much or how they could improve this kind of thing going forwards. Another example, just to kind of complete the set, these are the uninspiring and inspiring spaces from the Padlet wall that the students submitted to. So again, she put this up on the screen in that lecture of 120 people and said, these are the spaces you find inspiring and uninspiring. And again, it acts as this springboard. And she could say to the students, is there any patterns here? Are there any trends when you look at the inspiring spaces versus the uninspiring ones? You know, it, in a lot of the uninspiring ones, it's kind of desks in people's, you know, they're not very colourful, they're cluttered, you know, whereas the inspiring ones look minimal, they're colourful. You know, there's different types of seating. It's not just a desk and a chair. So again, able to draw out these kind of insights and allow the students to learn at a deeper level. So we've gone past the remember and understand, and now we're moving into those kind of higher levels of Bloom's taxonomy. And a kind of important thing to say is this saved Sarah time as well, because previously, she would go and get these examples from textbooks or find them online. But now what we're doing is we're crowdsourcing the material she's using in her lecture from the students themselves. So not only, you know, did it allow them to learn at a high level and, you know, stuff that they would only encounter initially in the lecture they'd already got up to speed with from the pre-class, it saved Sarah time too, because she didn't have to find these examples and we crowdsourced them instead. So, as I say, that's the kind of most kind of important insight from all of this. When it comes to flipped learning, if you don't show that connection and you don't show that the students, that the things that they're doing out of class are influencing the way that you're teaching and the things that they're learning in the classroom, it's very difficult to make the flipped model work. I'm going to pause there very just briefly in case there's any quick questions, and then I'm going to go into a bit more about how to implement this yourselves.
We have a comment, not a question, from Maria saying crowdsourcing resources from the students, and that she likes that very much.
Excellent. Great.
Apart from that, there aren't any other questions at this point.
Yeah. Okay. Excellent. We'll just move on to planning the face-to-face time then, because as I say, once you've moved to this model, you've got, you know, these 2-hour lectures to fill, or, you know, 1-hour seminars or whatever it is. And, you know, part of the model is then planning them to be active and collaborative. So as we've already covered, the first things to do are to address any significant gaps in knowledge and include these student responses and submissions. And then it's about building on the learning. So as we've kind of mentioned, you're freeing up this time so you can build on it and you can move above those remember and understand levels. With the Ansoff matrix, it's a good example. Sarah would have presented that for 10 minutes and they would have, you know, been at the remember and understand level. Now the students watch it as a video before they submit their own. She takes those, presents them to the class, and then she can go in at a much deeper level and say, you know, you've already applied the Ansoff matrix to Heinz. Let's take another company. Let's collectively create an Ansoff matrix for that company from a different sector, for example. So then they're already at the apply, analyze levels. It may be that she could even get them to the create level and she could say, you know, you've used the Ansoff matrix now for Heinz, you know, let's use it for another company. And then because she saved this 10, 15 minutes she used to spend explaining it, she could then dedicate that 15 minutes to what's deficient about the Ansoff matrix. What did you find when you were applying it that wasn't very good? Could we create our own new management model for analyzing a product portfolio that moves beyond the Ansoff matrix? And then you'd be getting students up to the very highest level of Bloom's taxonomy where they're creating their own kind of model to supersede one in the literature. And I suppose some kind of other things are, you know, plan them so they're accessible to all knowledge levels. And I'm just going to give an example of this, which is a balloon chair challenge. So a lot of you may be thinking, you know, even if a lot of students are completing these pre-class activities, what about those that aren't? You know, with Sarah, we got up to at times, you know, often over 90%. So in her class, we'd often see 95, 97% completion rates of the pre-class activities, but there's still some students that don't do them. And the trick here is designing activities which are accessible to all students, and allow those that have done the pre-class activities to extend their knowledge and those that haven't to still participate and get something from it. And I've taken this example because I think it illustrates that really effectively. So in this one, the students were asked to create a chair from balloons. So they worked in a team to create the chair. And as you can see here, they've got loads of balloons and some sticky tape and things, and they've made this chair. And I think it needs to support the weight of somebody. I think that may be an extra. I may be wrong with this. It's many years ago, so apologies to Sarah if that's not the case. But they create this chair, and this is a week when they've been looking at teamwork as part of the pre-class activities. So as part of that pre-class activity set, they've been learning about Belbin's team roles. So again, something you may be familiar with. It's a very kind of common management theory about the roles different people take when they're within a team. So you have these names that are given to them. So a very famous one is the plant. And the plant is the person that comes up with kind of creative ideas. You then have someone who's called the completer finisher. And that's somebody who might, you know, they may be less creative, they may not be, but they're really good at just getting stuff done. So, you know, this is something I'm sure, you know, you'll have different strengths in different areas, and you'll work with people that are, you know, much better at coming up with ideas, but maybe they never finish their projects. And then you've got other people that get things done and actually take things to completion. So they've been learning about all these different team roles in the pre-class activities. And the idea was, as they built the balloon chair, they were analyzing how each of them worked to see if they could work out who was a plant, who was a completer finisher, you know, who was one of the different types of roles that they'd learned about before they got to class. So the students that had done it were able to do that. The students that hadn't done the pre-class activities, they weren't able to do that analysis, but they were still able to participate and, you know, build the balloon chair. And what it meant was, the students that hadn't done those activities, they were hearing all these phrases that they'd not come across. So they were then asking the other students, what's a plant? What's a completer finisher? And what you then get is the students that have done it reinforcing their knowledge by explaining it to one of their peers. And then the student that hasn't done it, they're still getting the explanations of these different team roles. And they're then able, after the class, to go back and do the pre-class activity and have a second bite at the cherry. So there's nothing being lost here, because they're still getting exposed to all of the terms. And actually, over the course of building the balloon chair, they'll get a much better understanding of what these different team roles are than if Sarah had just got up at the front and given a 5-minute chalk and talk lecture about it. So that's key, like I say, creating these kind of accessible activities. And I've just got this as a summary slide now, just in case anyone's screenshot or something like that. This shows the progression from, I suppose, the student learning journey. So what the students are doing at each stage here. So they start completing the activities, the lecturer analyzes them, and then the students are going to work collaboratively. So I'm just going to zip through these ones here. But, you know, as I've said, linking that learning, that's vital. Trusting the approach. So there's a tendency, and I've seen it so many times working with teachers from all subjects, there's this kind of fear that the students haven't done the pre-class activities, so you then need to repeat everything that was in the pre-class activities in class. if you do that, the students won't see any value in doing the pre-class activities and it will be counterproductive. So I get that you might be, have kind of some trepidation around it, but it's kind of holding your nerve and just trusting the approach. So not, you know, if you've got the Ansoff Matrix as a video in the pre-class activity, don't give your 10-minute explanation of it in the class. As we've said, they need to be active and passive. And then the these next two are kind of interlinked. So setting expectations. If you move to this kind of model, in your first face-to-face time, and even in the kind of module guide that you give before students even take your module, you need to set the expectations that you're using this approach and that there's going to be this pre-class activity requirement and they're going to have to spend, it's not like a reading list where, you know, most of the class don't bother. You know, you're going to have to spend a good 1, 2, 3 hours before class working through these activities. So you really need to set those expectations. And not only before class, but in the actual class, Sarah used to show Moodle on the screen in her lecture and say, you know, and talk them through and actually click through and say, you need to be going through these activities every week. And she would be constantly reminding them. So she would be sending out emails as the week progressed. And she would be saying, you know, because again, Moodle quiz is great for this. You can see how many people completed really quickly. She can say, look, only 30% of the class have completed. If you haven't, you need to do it by, you know, whatever the deadline is. And she would be reminding them all through the week and to kind of push up those completion rates. And then the last one we've just covered, so I'm not going to go over that again, but yeah, tasks that everyone can interact with, but that allows them to build on the knowledge for those that have done the pre-class activities. So I don't think, again, this is something we need to spend too long, but this was just, again, to capture that idea about flipped learning being a flavor of blended learning. So this is a quotation from Garrison and Kanuka. And the reason for kind of making this link is so often blended learning is still weighted towards the face-to-face time for many classrooms, or for many courses, I should say. Moving to a flipped model, I think, allows you to get to a point where the online and the face-to-face class time is on equal footing, and not only for you as the educator, but for the students. So I've put here, it's not about where, but how. And the reason for putting that is, you know, when we're saying face-to-face time, that doesn't have to be in person. It could be on a Zoom call like this. You know, so you can still have people obviously doing asynchronous pre-class activities and then getting together for 2 hours on a Zoom and then doing the application stuff. You know, it's harder to make balloon chairs and things like that, but you can still have, you know, do a form of it if it's all entirely online. And this is just reinforces that, you know, according to Garrison and Kanuka, they see that as the real test. So if you're doing blended learning and that, you know, these two components aren't integrated and linked as we've been showing, then, you know, I'd ask the question, is it truly blended learning, or are you doing here what they've said, which is just adding a layer onto the dominant approach? So this is again a slide. I'm not going to go through this too much, but these are some reasons why you might want to use flipped learning as a blended learning model. I think I've kind of evangelized enough about it that I don't need to run through all of these. This is a slide just to show some of the comments that we received from students on Sarah's course. So we received overwhelmingly positive comments from the students. It would frequently be mentioned that the students love this. As you can see here, some students say it's the best part of the course. They really liked how the work they did in the pre-class was then built upon in the face-to-face time. In terms of kind of, you know, any negative comments that we got, the only ones really were around students saying, you know, it's a lot of work. So that comes back to the expectation setting. They would, you know, they'd be saying, you know, I 2 hours before the class or something, I don't have time to do this or something like that. But as the kind of module progressed and Sarah made it really clear, she would get students, she'd be oversubscribed every year because word got around that this was a really good module. And she would have, you know, students begging to be on the module. And I'm not exaggerating there. She would get emails which were almost at that level where it's like, please let me on this. My friend said it was amazing last year and things like that. So yeah, over time, those kind of comments about it being a lot of work and things became less and less. And one point on that is at UCL, there is a minimum amount of hours that students are supposed to do as part of all undergraduate models as independent learning. And, you know, spending an hour a week on pre-class activities gets nowhere near what they should be doing according to all of the kind of guidance. It's just they're used to other modules where they go to a lecture and then they maybe do a bit of reading in between or don't bother and then just go to another lecture. So that it was a bit of a shock to the system for some students. I can see there's a hand up.
Yes, there was a comment in the chat from Manfred saying, I think flipped learning doesn't work in the same way in language classes because students need more pronunciation and speaking activities. I let my students do all the homeworks on Moodle where they can check the correct answers. Only if they don't understand, I then explain it in class.
Yeah, okay. I think that's a good point, and it will vary from subject to subject, but I would say that there's not really a subject we've found, and I don't think language would be one where I don't think there would be an effective way of creating this. I actually studied languages, so I have some insight into how it's taught at university and you know, the different things, you know, the different parts that students go through from kind of listening, as you say, to speaking, to reading and writing. And I would say when I was studying, there was lots of things that we would, you know, in seminars, we did a lot of pronunciation, as you say, and speaking practice. But, you know, I did French literature modules. I did modules on Latin American history as part of my degree. And, you know, there was a lot with that work that could have certainly been flipped. And then when it came to verb conjugation, grammar, learning vocabulary, you know, all of these different types or kind of contextual information about when to use certain you know, types of language. You know, I'm just thinking now of French, like to and vous and things like that. I think a lot of that information is just remember, understand, and it could be developed, it could be delivered effectively as part of the pre-class activities. You know, even thinking back to school, that there would be often, you know, activities that we would do in class from textbooks and things that could effectively be done as pre-class. I'm happy to answer more questions on that later.
Catherine was also saying she did a lot of pronunciation and speaking with H5P activities, so even in French classes, and Tina's agreeing, saying H5P does some amazing things.
Okay, that's good to know, because that's I was learning it before H5P, so great to hear that, you know, if there's other examples, you know, where you can integrate that as well in the pre-class. Yeah. Okay, excellent. I'm just going to move on to one last case study then. So this is just to show you that it's a nice segue, actually. It doesn't just work with management. It works with other subjects. So here we've got mathematics. And there were actually similar criticisms when we started this, working with the maths lecturers, that it wouldn't work for their discipline. And we kind of showed comprehensively it did, and it was more effective. So with this one, it was actually a 10-week module, and there were 968 students from 8 different departments. So they had the pre-class activity sets, and then they had interactive workshops, which were basically what used to be the lectures. So these kind of large teaching workshops where they'd have about 200 students in a classroom. In terms of how it was assessed, as you can see, coursework, individual projects, and an exam. So slightly more modern looking version of Moodle quiz here, because we did this a couple of years ago. And I just wanted to show this because here we're using weekly case studies. So not only do we have the pre-class activities, we're using scenario-based learning as well. So for each of these weeks, what we did was we took a scenario and created it that related to the maths that was being studied. So in this week, the students were learning about calculus and derivatives and how they can be used to understand rates of change. So they were looking at sustainable coffee production in Brazil, and that was this kind of scenario that wrapped up all of the maths they were learning. And the purpose of this was to show how maths is applicable to the engineering disciplines they're studying, and it isn't just this abstract thing that they need to know. So we had exactly the same kind of approach where we would have students learning the theoretical mathematical content via short videos. And then we would be asking them questions, and again, a variety of different questions from the short form to the kind of portfolio, to the kind of application-based ones. And just to point out, previously, the lecturer you can see here would deliver a lecture like this. He would be in a lecture room for 2 hours with a visualizer going through the maths with a pen and paper. And that's how the whole lecture would be for 2 hours. And the students would watch him go through those works examples. But now all of this goes into the pre-class activities. And then in class, what they do is they work in groups to then apply the maths to the scenario. So that's what these kind of live workshops did. And this was a huge change from previous years because, like I say, it used to be either 100 slides with theoretical maths on or watching people go through works examples. And again, we went for the approach where we're linking this learning. So to give you some kind of examples, one of the things that students would do would they would in one of the weeks where it was about back of the envelope calculation. So that's calculations where students are just predicting something very quickly or estimating something. They were asked to come up with an answer as to how many tube drivers work on the London Underground. So they came up with a range of answers, and they were then plotted on a scatter plot and shown back to the students in class. And in this case, we had, you know, over 900 different responses. So again, you know, you can imagine it's quite mind-blowing for the students to see a scatter plot with 900 odd data points on, each of which represents their answers. And again, an excellent springboard for talking, you know, about it more. So in terms of the students, this one was actually first delivered in COVID. So these are from COVID, but 74% described the module as good or very good. So the student satisfaction was, 4 out of 5. We got a huge amount of positive feedback because, you know, during COVID, it was one of the most successful modules that we ran from engineering. We had students saying to us that they spent all week looking forward to it and that they loved working through the pre-class activities and things like that. So I'm just going to kind of quickly wrap up the key considerations. It does require a significant commitment to planning and development. It requires between 100 and 200 hours of your time, depending on the subject matter. For the maths module, maybe we're talking more 200 hours of your time. For Sarah's, maybe more 100 hours of your time. But I would say work in partnerships. So if you can work with an instructional designer at your organization, a learning technologist, or even another teacher or teaching assistant, it's really useful to buddy up with someone and get their input on it. And what I'd say, although, is it takes all of that time. Planning the lectures is then a lot quicker in that the activities you're planning for the lectures may be a group-based activity that's going to last for 45 minutes where the students are going to be collaborating. So you gain some of the time that you lose in the planning later down the line. The other thing I'd say is be sustainable with your recording your videos and things like that. Students often prefer a conversational style. Don't think you have to produce like BBC level productions. Doing something where, you know, just sitting like this, webcam style, visualizer style, whatever it is, the students often react really well to it, and they don't expect you to have really high production values or for you to be reading off scripts or anything like that. And they actually often prefer it when it's quite conversational. Just the final note I've said, don't let it put you off. You'll reap the rewards in the long run. And Matt and Sarah would certainly attest to that. So references are there if anyone wants to take a screenshot. And then I've overrun a bit slightly because I've been answering questions after we've gone, but there's a couple more minutes for any questions that people have.
We did have one question from Andrew. How does generative AI change how you deliver flipped learning?
I would say that isn't something that we've tried. So maybe that's an extension of the work. The last time I was working with an academic to do. This was before the you know, the advent of the latest kind of generative AI models. In terms of how it would impact it, off the top of my head, you know, the students, I suppose there's so many angles. If you're talking about students not doing the work properly and generating responses that they're just submitting and things like that, I think that just comes back to, you know, the age old kind of issues around students either plagiarizing or cheating themselves out of learning. Universities obviously have policies for that kind of thing, or at least we do at UCL. I mean, there may be some teachers that use it to help work out which activities should go in and out of class. Going right to the beginning, it might be that some of the models are able to help you with that process. But yeah, I don't think it in any way makes it redundant as an approach, or you know, or stops anyone doing it in the way we have.
Great, thank you, Matt. There aren't any other questions, just lots of thank yous and a few people who have to leave. So yeah, I think because we answered some during the session, but thank you very much to everyone who has been involved. And thank you so much, Matt, for coming and sharing your experiences with us today. It was a really interesting session with some great discussion as well.
Yeah, excellent. Well, yeah, thanks all for taking the time to stop by and
cover off a few things to wrap up the session. So if you're still around, I can let you know about if you'd like to get involved further with Moodle Academy. You can vote for topics, and you can also contribute your own topics that you'd like to see us cover in future webinars and online courses. You can also propose, if you'd like to hear from a particular presenter or on a particular topic, you can propose yourself or others to present webinars and co-create short online courses with us. So you can register your interest on the Get Involved course, which is available from Moodle Academy. And we'd love to hear from you as well if you're interested in helping us translate Moodle Academy into other languages. We have a Translate Moodle Academy course you can take, and once you've done that, you'll get access to translating the content into your own language. And on the next page as well, we have information about earning badges. So for our courses, you'll earn a badge, and we'd love it if you can share about this webinar and other webinars and courses that are available on Moodle Academy. Help spread the word. If you're interested in upskilling and you're a educator, we have the Moodle Educator Certification, and we also are about to launch the Moodle Administrator Certification. So those programs are run through our partner network, and it's the expert qualification if you have quite a bit of experience and you want to certify your skills. But anyway, thank you for joining us today, and I hope to see you on the Moodle Academy course forums and in upcoming webinars. If you've got any further questions, you can write them onto the discussion forums for the Moodle community to answer. So thanks again. Thanks, Matt. Thanks, everyone.
Thanks. Bye-bye.